We have a wonderful service in which God is going to bless us all. And it's a mix of praise songs, prayer, messages, testimonies, and an opportunity for us to be together in this safe and holy space. God bless you all. Thank you again for coming together. We have an audio video, I think, song of our our Prairie Lutheran Church praise band. We worship. As you are able, I invite you to stand as we begin our service or continue with our call to worship. Or confession. Or call to worship. Okay. This is from Psalm 111. What he does is glorious and splendid, and his goodness continues forever. His miracles are unforgettable. The Lord is kind and merciful. He gives food to those who fear him. He remembers his agreement forever. And let's continue standing as we spend a time of confession using these words together. God of grace and mercy, we confess in this time of pandemic, we have sinned against you in our thoughts and actions. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have trafficked in attitudes, whether to mask or not to mask. We have failed to consider those who have most been affected by the virus. Forgive us and lead us to your cross. And let's take a few moments of personal confession. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I have good news to announce. Jesus has heard your confession. He has overlooked them and he has forgotten them. As a called and ordained pastor of the Church of Christ, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all your sin. In the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. As forgiven people, I invite you to greet one another with a holy wave as we gather together as forgiven people of God. You may be seated. We now hear the word of the Lord.
Good morning. Happy Sunday, everyone. We are never far from Jesus. The promise of the Christ child is this: Jesus is always with us. Even on the days where it feels like we are lost or alone, we can know that the presence of our shepherd clothes us in hope and in love. Our reading today comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 52. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the festival according to the custom. After the festival was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled on for a day. Then they began looking for him amongst their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. And after 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw this, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Here ends the lesson.
And at this time, I'd like to invite Mark Bergren, their point person, to come on up and introduce us and welcome. Welcome, Mark.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Joel. Good morning.
Good morning.
You guys a little bit. You guys have been supporting us year after year after year, and praise the Lord, this year is not any different. Thank you so much. The guys who are in this program today are here because of your support, because of your prayers, because of your volunteerism, because of the ways that you guys have leaned in, even become mentors. People in this community have supported Teen Challenge very well, and so thank you so much. Thank you even just for taking the courage to say, no, we want to continue to host, even if it's very nuanced and very different than normal. Even looking at that picture, it's like, oh man, I miss those days. But it is so sweet to continue to unite the body of Christ around the message that addiction is not a death sentence. And that's just what I wanted to start by saying. Happy New Year. We're in 2021. It's been a heck of a year for Teen Challenge and throughout 2020. You're probably asking, how did you guys do it? We had to work closely with the CDC, closely with the Minnesota Department of Health. We worked tirelessly. We basically revamped our entire admissions process. We never had to close our admissions doors, which is a praise request, that we continued to say, no, people need help. People are falling through the cracks. Addiction is running rampant in isolation like never before, and we want our resources to be made available. So what are the processes that we need to follow in order to make sure as many people in this hurting time can be helped? And so We feel like we conquered that. It has been a roller coaster inside the program. Staff have gotten COVID, clients have gotten COVID. It seems like we've kind of been like this throughout 2020. But God has protected so many people, and we just are in awe of the many testimonies along the way of God's provision, God's kindness, clients who are really being refined by the Holy Spirit right now, saying, "Hey, I want the Lord. The blinders are on. The distractions of the world are away." And these men are safer in our program in the past year than out on the streets or out in their past life. And so their past addiction is really way more dangerous than any COVID risk in the program. I know that sounds pretty crazy to say, but these men are walking testimonies. And you guys, again, have hosted us year in, year out. You guys know our heartbeat and the ministry. Over 50 years ago, just started by a man named David Wilkerson, and today there's over 1,000 centers worldwide. And it's amazing, and we give God the glory for each life that comes into our program. Right now, we're serving just under 900 clients on any given day throughout the state, up in Brainerd and Duluth and down in Rochester, and teen boys facility out in Buffalo, Minnesota, and then all around Minneapolis. We have a bunch of men and women's facilities. But we are so thankful to see that God's growth has not stunted. We're actually opening a new women's facility later in 2021 here, probably in the next 9 or 10 months. And it's going to have short-term women, long-term women, and then it's basically a whole new facility to allow more women's programming. And it's going to have a chapel and a cafeteria. And so there's a whole wing, actually, for families and kids to come and visit mom while she's in treatment. Anyway, I'm just blitzing this information at you guys just to say there's still a lot of traction that Teen Challenge has been able to maintain, and we just praise the Lord for our church partners who make it possible. And so, again, thank you for having us here. Lord's a-leaping. Now I'm going to invite you guys up here. No, I'm thankful that you guys can come on up. I think there's a lot of misconceptions right now on addiction, and even though the statistics might be scary and even though it might feel intimidating to even talk about addiction, we want to be a resource here, and so we actually have a resource table in the back. I'd love to stand 6 feet away and engage you guys in any questions that you have, because while we're here, each one of these guys represents a whole wonderful story of transformation. And so if you have questions or thoughts or ideas about addiction, we want to answer them. We want to give our a piece of the pie, if you will. And so we want to bless you guys with anything that God has deposited into us. But with that said, you guys look good up here. You guys look good. Maybe we should get matching masks next time. What does your mask say? Not today, Satan. Well, these guys look good. Let's give it up for the Minnesota Dalton Teen Challenge Choir. And if you guys want to sing along with us, you certainly can. So thank you so much.
Chains are gone, I've been and set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. What God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine, will be our forever mine.
We're good. Bobby, thank you so much. We're going to be sharing a few testimonies now, and I'm going to invite Tim to come on down and share his first.
Hey, good morning, everybody. This is pretty neat for me. This is actually my hometown, Eden Prairie. I lived here for, I think I moved out of the city in like about 18, 19. My mom was a school teacher here for about, for 32 years, still lives in the city. I remember when, my backyard was a cornfield in the far end of town. Growing up here, by going through all the school systems here, grew up pretty decent, three brothers, all older than me. Not a bad home life. My dad left in fourth grade. That hurt me a lot, having my father figure leave. Growing up doing well in sports and Cub Scouts, Boy Scouts, all that kind of stuff. But after he left, I just started just misbehaving. Kind of lost some family structure. My mom kind of took over both roles. That was really hard on her. And then she was above and beyond as a school teacher, always bringing the schoolwork home. If anyone knows school teachers, they're always, kind of underpaid and doing above and beyond things if they really care about their students. Some usage came around of, marijuana drinking. Drinking was big in high school. I got my hands on an ID that looked just like me. Soon enough, I was buying alcohol. And, that was just a thing to do on the weekends. That was just right here in the hometown, Eden Prairie. And that was definitely a thing to do. Lots of other things were available too, especially if you had the money to buy it. I was purchasing things, blocks down the road from here. and I was doing other bad things in this town. Like I stole stuff from Pax Christi just for fun, and I returned it. And I left a note, and the pastor actually came out to my van, and I left a note saying, sorry, I took the stuff just for dumb fun. And he's like, are you the guy in the van? Because I just signed a man in the van. And I'm like, yeah, that's me. I'm in a van, you know. And he's like, thank you. No, I forgive you. That was just some of the dumb stuff, you know, I would do, just rebellious things. Went on to college for a couple years, and had some bad stuff happen since then. Best friend died. We put in a car accident, and I decided to try methamphetamine for a little bit. Terrible choice, terrible, terrible choice. And ended up putting that down and dropped out of art school. Got into the restaurant industry, worked my way up to management. Thought I had a good life, you know, making like $55,000 a year. That was a life of just a lot of drinking. And I gave that up because I wasn't happy. And I just, it was drinking all the time, you know, liters of vodka a day. And I was just broken. I was a lost sheep. Just totally lost sheep. Just a little weak lost sheep. That was me. I thought I was strong, had my stuff together, and I was definitely not. That was just all my understanding, and I had nothing to lean on. And I went to Teen Challenge. I went in for a 90-day program, and COVID hit, and I knew that if I went back out to the streets, I was going into a world where nothing but liquor stores were open, and I would end up drinking again. And I thought I would die. I was on the edge of suicide already to begin with, and while I was there, I found Jesus. And Jesus, through Jesus, the only way to our Lord is Jesus Christ. And it's been such a tough time, even though I'm there, I'm safe, and it's hectic. Even inside of that place, it's still hard. But I found Jesus, and that's what keeps me alive. That's the only thing that I have. It's so many times. I got my brothers. I got support, but I got Jesus. That's the only thing I have. So many times, every day, so many things are hard, but still at night, I say thank you to Jesus, and I wake up, and I say thank you to Jesus. So, thank you for having us here.
Tim, thanks so much, man. Thanks for sharing. And what I hear in your voice is just the concreteness of understanding things spiritually, and what you're coming from, and what you're saying yes to, and what you're turning away from, and the enemy's schemes, and the deceitfulness, and the short-term solutions of the substances in your past. But now you're seeing some eternal perspective, and I just hear that in your voice. And strong men understand that, and strong men are weak men before God, and use God's strength. And I just see that in you, so I commend you, brother. Thanks for sharing. Bobby, you want to share? Please welcome Bobby to share his testimony.
Hi, everyone. My name is Bobby A. Bobby D was the singer just a little bit ago. Gets confusing sometimes, but my story starts out when I was really young. I don't really remember before I was five, but when I was five, my mother met my stepdad. His name's Mark. She married him, and I never remember my biological parents being together. So it didn't really affect me. I was always born into a separate home, going to my dad's every other weekend. And then she married my stepdad when I was five, and nice way of putting it, he wasn't a nice man. He would beat me for pretty much everything. I'd get bad grades at school. I'd be too hyper, or I'd wouldn't finish my meals, and he'd beat me with plastic hangers, extension cords, belts, belt buckles, sticks, you name it. And when I was 8 years old, I ran away in the middle of winter. First cop car ride, They brought me back to the school and asked me why I ran away, and I was so afraid I couldn't tell them. I said, I can't tell you. And the nurse checked me over and saw all the bruises and welts, and cops go to my house, and my stepdad's nowhere to be found, and my mom said he did that to himself. So it was hard, and shortly after that, my mother and my stepdad took me and my two sisters to Harvey, Illinois. We moved from Minnesota to Illinois, so I didn't get to see my dad every other weekend anymore. That's where I was first baptized. I went to a Lutheran church in Harvey. I was baptized, I sang in the choir. I wanted to know God, but it was kind of hard because I grew up hearing what's done in darkness does come to light, and God don't like ugly, while my stepdad's beating me until I can't scream anymore. Long story short, when I was about 12 years old, my sisters saved me. My stepdad had beaten me until I couldn't move, and I was laying there on the ground, and at about 1 in the morning, they carried me across the street to a payphone. And I remember it so clearly that it was pouring rain, and they called my dad. Sorry, I cry every time, this sucks. They called my dad, and he drives from Minnesota to Harvey, Illinois in 5.5 hours. And if any of you know how far that is, he was going really fast. But yeah, he just took us, and I ended up living with my dad at that point. I lived with him for about 2 years, 3 years. When I was 14, I got into marijuana, and that was my new love. Made me stop thinking about everything. It numbed all my emotions. I fell deep into it immediately. I was addicted from the very start. Wanted to do it every day, all day. That's all I ever wanted to do at that point. Occasionally I would drink, but it got so bad that I started ditching school to go get high. And when I was 15, my dad gave me the ultimatum, either stop using drugs and alcohol and go to school, or you can't live here. And I chose drugs and alcohol. So at 15, I was homeless. I was homeless until I was 18 years old. My mom wouldn't let me stay with them. My dad no longer let me stay there. So I was couch hopping for a while, homeless shelters for a while, outside a lot of the time. Slept on a workbench in a shed for about 3 months in the middle of winter. Then when I was 18, I was incarcerated. Met my first love after I got out of jail. I had a kid with her at 20. Her name's Shanna. She's a beautiful, beautiful daughter. The girl I was with, her name's Stephanie, she was unfaithful. I relapsed really bad. Fell back into my addiction, and hadn't been a part of her life for a while. A couple years passed, I meet my now ex-wife. I was with her for 9 years, 15 treatments later, 2 daughters later. I'm now divorced. Before I came here, I was on a 5-month binge. I started with marijuana, moved to methamphetamine, and then I ended with alcohol. I was drinking about a 1.75 of vodka every day. My friend Adam, he's like a brother to me, he's up here too. He called me while I was out in the street and he said, come stay with me. And I went to his house and I called Teen Challenge and I said, I need a bed really bad. And at the time, the pandemic was so bad that they said, oh, it's gonna be a few weeks, everyone's trying to get in here. And a few weeks turned into a month and a half to 2 months. And by the time couple days before I got into Teen Challenge, I said, I just want to die. I don't want to live anymore. I'm so sick of all this crap. Why can't I get this? And then I get the phone call. We got a bed for you on Monday. I remember trying to wait for the weekend to pass, and it was like time would never stop going. It went on and on and on. It felt like forever. I remember sitting on Adam's bed, and I said, I don't think God exists. I don't think he's real. Why would a God that says he loves me let me go through this? Thank God for his faith. He held up his Bible and said, God loves you. You wouldn't have made it to my house if God didn't love you. Anyways, I made it. I made it to Teen Challenge. 5 months in, I was still pretty depressed. Or 5 days in, I was still very depressed, and I was in my small counseling group, Scott Carlson's, the LADC, and he says, be raw, how do you feel? And I said, I want to die. I don't like life anymore. I think it's not worth living. Only thing that's keeping me here is the fact that my girls would grow up without a father. And one of my co-clients gets up and he says, that's a dang lie. Gets in my face. He says, that's a lie from the enemy. I remember reading the Bible that night and I stumbled upon Matthew 10, verse 37. It said, if you love your mother and father more than me, you're not worthy of me. If you love your brother and sister more than me, you're not worthy of me. If you love your wife and children more than me, you're not worthy of me. If you try to hold on to your life, you'll lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you'll gain it. It was like fireworks blew off in my head. For the first time in my life, the Bible was real. What he said was true. I was like, God, you're real. I surrender. And I remember having these, it's like 4 months of just utter peace. And then my divorce finalized. It was like a piece of me broke. And I was sad again, and I was angry again. Then my grandma died. Then my grandpa died. Then my 24-year-old friend overdosed on heroin and died. I went through a rough patch, and it was hard. And I remember going up to one of the recovery coaches, John. I said, how is God good through all this? What's going on? And he said, you mean to tell me you got divorced? Your grandma, your grandpa, and your friend all died. Yeah, look where you are. You're in a place with mental health professionals, LADCs, chaplains, recovery coaches, and 40 other brothers that you can lean your head on and talk to, and they'll lift you up and support you. You mean to tell me that God's not good? You wanted to die before you came in here. What do you think you would have done if you weren't in here during all that? I'll end with this. I'm a month away from level 4, which means I have 3.5 months left here at Teen Challenge. I remember my second contract. There's an article, Relationship with Jesus, says that the root word of the word of God's mercy is womb. It relates the love of God to the love of a mother. And that a mother could go into a crowded room and distinguish the cry of her child instantly. And let me tell you, my God, he heard my cry out of all the people in the world that are crying this year. So praise God. Thank you for having us.
so thankful for you. What'd you say? I told you I was a crier. Yeah. I'm thankful you're alive. I'm thankful that right now you have leadership calling on your life. You have boldness in your eyes, that you have this deep-set humility. You're thankful. I get to see your life more than most, and I'm so sorry for the abuse that you've had to live through, and that's not the father heart. And I see so much, I see so much overflow from who you are, Bobby, and I'm just really impressed with that. So thank you for sharing. Thank you for taking courage to be methodical and just sharing a real picture with us, because that, I think, everybody is going to take home a real solid moment of understanding how difficult, not just high picture, but some deep low moments. And thank you for being vulnerable and sharing that. So what I have in my heart, actually, is before we sing one last song, I'm just going to even pray for people. I encourage you. There's a lot of people who are still hurting out there, going through the muck and the haze and the difficulty and the spiritual battle that Bobby is referencing. And I just challenge you to even think about that one person, the coworker, the friend, the neighbor, the family member. And I just want to be praying for them. And so just bow your head with me real quick. Lord, this is a moment where we just say, as a one body of Christ, we come together and we acknowledge that there's hurting people in our state, and we want you to help them. You know exactly where they're at. You know exactly what they're processing. You know exactly how to speak to them. And right now, we submit a prayer that you engage them, that you engage their spirit, that they know without a doubt that there's a God who has a call for them, that they are going to be pushed forward through a difficult and yet necessary process to see life on the other side. Give them hope, give them healing, allow them to recover. Give them a glimmer of hope in their eye that they want to attain, and they want to take a few steps forward and give an organization a call, give a friend a call, and just raise their hand and say, I am struggling and I need help. Give them courage today, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's give it up for all the guys one more time here. They all have incredible stories. I encourage you guys, again, Pastor Joel is going to get up here and talk a little bit more about the practicals of giving, but giving is essential right now for our organization. We need your prayers. And we need your finances. And so if you can give a little, please do. If you can give a lot, please do. But we lean into a church bodies right now. It's very few and far between when we get to even meet in person. And so I know that there's not many people in this room, but I just challenge you to lean in wherever God has you in this moment. It's been a difficult time for everybody, but we just trust that you guys want to give long term, and so thank you so much for giving in the past. Thank you for hosting us today and encouraging us, and even just allowing us to come into a church and not just have it be a building on a road somewhere, but come in, see faces. For those of us who didn't grow up in a local church, this is a beautiful time when we get to share some real and raw stories and be received in love and be received in kindness, and a place where we can feel understood as well. And so God gets the glory this morning. Thank you so much for hosting us. And please sing this last song with us. Travis, come on down.
Seems like all I could see was the struggle. Haunted by ghosts that lived in my past. Bound up in shackles of all my failures. Want How long is this gonna last? Then you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. And wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. All my life I have been called unworthy. Named by the voice of my shame and regret. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. Because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, 'cause his day is long dead and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and a hope that will carry me home. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away.
Thank you for your voices, your spirits, your testimony, your song, and your courage. As I was listening this morning, I was thinking about Jesus when he went up to a hill in Galilee and he gave the Sermon on the Mount, and he said, blessed are the poor, blessed are the persecuted. You know, as you listen to that, it's sort of a bummer of a talk by Jesus, and he says, blessed are those who are broken, basically. And that's the point of the gospel, that we find Jesus in our brokenness. And I want to thank you men for being so transparent and letting us into your experiences. A little thing for Bobby Day. I didn't realize these face masks are also good for hankies for tears. thank you for another use for that. But you know, as you think about Jesus, when he did his ministry and his preaching and teaching and healing, doing all these wonderful things, what did it give him? He was strung up on a cross. He was killed. And then he was buried and he was dead. And then when he rose from the dead, you know what the first thing he did? He came back to the disciples and said, let me show you what it's all about. My wounds. Jesus didn't come back as this sort of this miracle Superman kind of guy. Hey, I got it all done. I beat it all. He said, I am wounded. I am broken for your sake. And we do as human beings a great job covering that all up. Oh, I don't have any problems. I don't have any issues. And that is so not true. And when we do that, then we try to cover up our life with drugs and alcohol and all kinds of stuff that gets us in the, way off the track. I want to thank you, men, this morning, because you helped us see Jesus again. Jesus is not this faraway Superman. Jesus is in our wounds and in our brokenness. Jesus is this one person in the world that you will find that heals us by his wounds. He doesn't say, get your act together. God's got his act to heal us by his wounds. And so thank you for being real, because we in Eden Prairie a lot of times are not real. We dress up nice, we drive nice cars, we say nice things, but we are broken and we need Jesus. And today I saw Jesus in you. So thank you. Mark mentioned Minnesota Adult Teen Challenge is a ministry that depends, like any other ministry, organization, company, or business, on cash. And I'm so proud to say that Prairie Lutheran, we are a generous congregation. We love to give not only our time and our bodies, but we like to give dollars. We don't just say, oh, I believe in it, and I'll maybe do something. No, we get out our checkbooks, we get out our wallets, we get out our accounts, and we make contributions. And so again, this morning, Prairie Lutheran, let's be who we are. Let's be the generous people God has allowed us to be, and we have continually to be for this cause. I know with this non-touch time, we don't even do envelopes and trays here at Prairie Lutheran Church. We have trays out in the narthex that you can put envelopes in. If you have a checkbook, I doubt anybody. Who brings checkbooks around anymore? But hey, go online to Minnesota Adult Teen Challenge and make a big contribution. I think this is still legal. Year-end giving, I think, do you have till January 7th? I don't know, post-dated, pre-dated, whatever you do. But just love on this community that's healing people in Minnesota and around the world. And I know God will smile, and he'll keep healing those who are broken like us. Our service now continues. I'm not sure. Jonathan, where are we in our service? That's what we're doing. Okay. As you're able, I invite you to stand and let's pray. I invite you to join your hearts as we pray together the world, the church, and all those who are in need. Let's pray. Creator God, give us hearts to see the things that our eyes overlook. Open our minds to hear your still small voice, which is behind the silence that often envelops our listening ears. Teach us to continually praise you for the love that you have for us. We humbly pray, Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus, strengthen and unite us as your people, just as the waters of baptism strengthen and bind us to you. Thank you for bringing us the powerful witness and the life-transforming stories of the members of Minnesota Adult and Teen Challenge. May their words speak to the lives of those who are here today, in person and online, and inspire many to follow you in the days to come. Guide and protect them as they journey to new places and share your good news. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Spirit of the living God, continue to sustain us with your healing and hope. Be especially this week with Linda Rhodes, Ellie Kronlocken, Lee Moran, Jared Spanbauer, and Mason Linscott. And hear now these names that we offer in the quiet of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we begin a new year, we give you thanks for the many courageous people who stood up to serve last year. In the midst of the pandemic, healthcare workers stood in the gap to bless the vulnerable with your presence and healing. Let us learn from them and put others first in our lives, as you have shown us in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear our spoken and silent prayers, O God, and reveal us your presence, and thank you for giving us these words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. We have just a few announcements. I'd like to invite Caroline to come on up.
Good morning. What a special Sunday. We have just a few announcements today, talking about a few things going on. But first, we want to talk about something that we have done. We collected donations in the month of December for healthcare workers, and I am just so blown away by our congregation. Every time we do a donation for something, you guys don't bring the cheap things, the things on clearance. You guys really bless everyone that you see that is in need, and that is an incredible gift. So I got together with some volunteers last week, and we put together 20 full blessing baskets for healthcare workers with granola bars and cookies and gum and emergency and chapstick and thank you notes and all these wonderful things. So I've had a couple people say, how are we getting those into hospitals? Well, if you, a member of our congregation, are a healthcare worker, whether that is a PT or a doctor or a nurse or anything that you consider healthcare, we want to use our congregation members to help get those into hospitals. So I know I have a couple people grabbing baskets after the service today. You can pick up one, or if you work in a place that there's a day shift or a night shift, we want you to take two. So if you are a healthcare worker, we want to bless you with those blessing baskets for you and your staff. And looking forward with programming through the end of our programming year, we have decided we are going to continue virtually through Ash Wednesday, which I think is in March. I could be wrong. I didn't look at a calendar. but I'm just predicting that it's in March. It's usually sometime in there. But we will continue virtually for all ages. So adult, middle, high school, and children's programming will continue virtually. And those start up this week. I think our first day back to programming virtually is Wednesday. So we will keep you updated when COVID starts to look better and we can start to do some more things in person. But that is how we're going to continue as of today. That concludes our announcements, and I invite you to now stand for the benediction.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
We fall to our knees as we humbly pray.